The venerated Socrates was born in Athens, Greece, circa 470 BC. Many people consider him to be the father of Western philosophy. Others think of him as an insightful teacher and an enlightened master. Socrates believed that an individual's main purpose on earth was to discover the truth. He stated that most people focus their lives around their families, careers, and social responsibilities, when in fact they should be concerned about the welfare of their souls. With compassion for all life, Socrates followed and promoted a vegetarian diet. Most of the information about Socrates, his life and his philosophy was transcribed after his departure by two of his students, Plato and Xenophon. These disciples wrote about their master in several books, in which Socrates is depicted as the main character. One of Plato's most famous and influential philosophical works is entitled Symposium. It features valuable dialogues between Socrates and others, mainly on the topic of love, the different ways it is manifested, and as a transcendent path to attain spiritual heights. We will now read a selected part from Plato's well-known work Symposium. The text depicts a gathering of notable men during a banquet where they exchange philosophical thoughts. In one of the dialogues, Socrates recollects his conversation with the seer and priestess Theotima about the idea and nature of love. In this dialogue with Theotima, where love is referred to as a great spirit, we find the origin of the concept of Platonic love. "What then is love?" I asked. "Is he mortal?" "No." "What then?" "As in the former instance, he is neither mortal nor immortal, but in a mean between the two." "What is he, Theotima?" "He is a great spirit, daimon, and like all spirit, he is intermediate between the divine and the mortal." "And what," I said, "is his power?" "He interprets," she replied, "between gods and men, conveying and taking across to the gods the prayers of men, and to men the commands and replies of the gods. He is the mediator who spans the chasm which divides them, and therefore in him all is bound together, and through him the arts of the prophet and the priest, and all, prophecy and incantation, find their way. For God mingles not with man, but through love all the communion and converse of God with man. Whether awake or asleep is carried on. The wisdom which understands this is spiritual." Now the spirits, or intermediate powers, are many and diverse, and one of them is love. The truth of the matter is this: no god is a philosopher or seeker after wisdom, for he is wise already, nor does any man who is wise seek after wisdom. Neither do the ignorant seek after wisdom, for herein is the evil of ignorance, that he who is neither good nor wise is nevertheless satisfied with himself. He has no desire for that of which he feels no want. "But who then, Diotima," I said, "are the lovers of wisdom, if they are neither the wise nor the foolish?" "A child may answer that question," she replied. "They are those who are in the mean between the two. Love is one of them. For wisdom is the most beautiful thing, and love is of the beautiful. And therefore, love is also a philosopher, or lover of wisdom, and being a lover of wisdom is in a mean between the wise and the ignorant." "When a man loves the beautiful, what does he desire?" Diotima asked. I answered her that the beautiful may be his. Still, she said, the answer suggests a further question. What is given by the possession of beauty? "To what you have asked," I replied, "I have no answer ready." Then she said, "Let me put the word good in the place of the beautiful and repeat the question once more. If he who loves good, what is it then that he loves?" "The possession of the good," I said. "And what does he gain who possesses the good?" "Happiness," I replied. There is less difficulty in answering that question. "Yes," he said, "the happy are made happy by the acquisition of good things, nor is there any need to ask why a man desires happiness. The answer is already final." You're right, I said. And is this wish and this desire common to all? And do all men always desire their own good, or only some men? What say you? All men, I replied, the desire is common to all. Why then, she rejoined, are not all men, Socrates, said to love, but only some of them? Whereas you say that all men are always loving the same things. I myself wonder, I said, why this is. There is nothing to wonder at, she replied. The reason is that one part of love is separated off and receives the name of the whole, but the other parts have other names. Give an illustration, I said. She answered me as follows. There is poetry, which, as you know, is complex and manifold. All creation or passage of non-being into being is poetry or making, and the processes of all art are creative, and the masters of arts are all poets or makers. Very true. Still, she said, you know that they are not called poets, but have other names. Only that portion of the art which is separated off from the rest and is concerned with music and meter, rhythm of poetry, is termed poetry, and they who possess poetry in this sense of the word are called poets. Very true, I said, and the same holds of love. For you may say generally that all desire of good and happiness is only the great and subtle power of love, but they who are drawn towards him by any other path, whether the path of money-making or gymnastics or philosophy, are not called lovers. The name of the whole is appropriated to those whose affection takes one form only. They alone are said to love or to be lovers. I replied that you are right. She said, the simple truth is that men love the good. Yes, I said, to which must be added that they love the possession of the good. Yes, that must be added. And not only the possession, but the everlasting possession of the good. That must be added too. Then love, she said, may be described generally as the love of the everlasting possession of the good. That is most true. All this she taught me at various times when she spoke of love. And I remember her once saying to me, what is the cause, Socrates, of love and the attendant desire? See you not how? All animals, birds, as well as beasts, in their desire of procreation are in agony when they take the infection of love, which begins with the desire of union, whereto is added the care of offspring, on whose behalf the weakest are ready to battle against the strongest, even to the uttermost, and to die for them, and will let themselves be tormented with hunger or suffer anything in order to maintain their young. Man may be supposed to act thus from reason, but why should animals have these passionate feelings? Can you tell me why? Again, I replied that I did not know, she said to me. And do you expect ever to become a master in the art of love if you do not know this? But I have told you already, Theotima, that my ignorance is the reason why I come to you, for I am conscious that I want a teacher. Tell me then the cause of this and of the other mysteries of love. Thoughtful viewers, it was an honor to have your presence for today's words of wisdom.